have a legend from the world of magic comedy who's been with me before and will be with me again. All right, now, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Well, not welcome, because this is not the Mind Dog TV podcast. This is the Mind Dog TV Podathon, so it's not officially back to this program, but back into my world. Welcome, the fabulous John Valentino.
How you doing? How are you holding up?
It's not how, it's if, and so far I am, so that's all that matters.
How many hours you got?
Where are we? This is 1 hour. This is 25. 20, we're in the 26th hour. We're going for 40. So 20 hours.
Wow.
20 hours left.
You're a brave man.
I'm a retarded man.
You had hair when this started.
Yeah, I did. So how have you been, my friend?
I've been good. I've been real good. Well, I've been better. I mean, I got a prescription for Christmas to get a hip replacement. I've been surfing for 50 years. And my friend from high school, we have a new pool, sent me this exercise that's supposed to make getting up on a surfboard easier. And I did it for 2 weeks and started having pain in my hip and went to the doctors. And they told me I have arthritic changes and a torn labrum from sitting on the surfboard for 50 years.
Wow. That's bizarre.
Yeah.
I didn't know. I thought surfing was the healthiest or one of the healthiest.
Well, that's what you think. What do you think? But they told me that there's three injuries that all surfers have after 50 years. It's either a neck injury from arching your neck while you're paddling, a shoulder, or a hip from sitting on a surfboard.
Just doing that is reminding me of what shape my body is in from all this stuff. Neck, head, all this stuff. Yeah, can't do that while you're
not fun getting old.
Yeah. No, but you're in Florida, and although you're wearing a New York Islanders t-shirt, yeah. I like that, or jersey. Florida's kind of a hotbed for all the cooties that are going around.
We have a governor that's insane.
Yeah.
Ron Death Sentence, we call him.
Yeah, Ron Death Sentence. Death Sentence. That's good. Are you avoiding people like the plague? Or, I mean, because it's
I've been triple. You know, I've had my booster and I've had everything, and I'm just being careful. I'm wearing a mask. I did have a comedy show like last weekend at a big kind of event of like 500 people.
Whoa!
So what I did was the woman that booked us, it was like an over 50s retirement community thing. So the woman that booked me said, I need you to do that trick where you pull a rope through your body. So I have two people that are vaccinated that will show you their negative COVID cards that are having tests the day before. And then I just changed my entire act where I didn't call anybody up on stage. And the audience, you know, it was a legitimate stage, so they were pretty far away from me. And I still feel fine. But the money was too good to turn down.
That's a motivating factor, whether people, and at least you're honest enough to admit it, but I always say, well, how could somebody take that gig? And I always forget about the financial.
It was actually kind of fun. You know, it was really kind of fun to kind of reinvent my act, because my act has always been all volunteers,
right?
So I think working the Magic Castle the last couple of years has sort of like brought me back to like maybe the roots of magic, whereas before it was like more comedy.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Speaking of a couple of things, you're talking about reinventing, and Jeff Altman is coming on. I think he's on next after you. I have to look at the schedule. But I had put out a challenge to him that we would do a trick for each other in this format, which he's a sleight of hand guy.
Right.
And I find that pretty challenging to do a legitimate magic trick in this. But with half a brain cell now, I don't have the confidence that I could do it well, and the presentation will suck.
Sure you can.
Well, I practiced it on call at 5 o'clock this morning, and I messed it up big time. I was like, oh, man, I can't believe I can't do this. I just don't have the brain cell.
It's also hard because everything is backwards.
Yeah.
On StreamYard. Right.
Yeah.
Right. It's like your right hand is like your left hand. And so.
Yeah, and all of it. And just, but definitely you're not supposed to do magic on sleep deprivation. Cause you need your, you know, you need your wits about you. And I just, even though I'm trying very hard, you could tell by my speech. If this was a clinical study, the people in the room would be, oh, his speech is slurring. He's he can't find simple words.
They'd have electrodes hooked up to you. Oh, yeah, there's one. He slurred just there.
Yeah.
19 hours and 36 minutes.
Yeah. So I reached out to Silky, but I didn't hear him back because I thought he would have been a great bookend for this piece. Have you on, talk about your magic, and then have Jeff on do that piece, and then have Silky on to talk about
it. Even knows. I know that he's having, I'm not making excuses for him, but I know that he works as a graphic artist during the daytime and everybody quit.
Yeah.
So I guess everyone quit, and he's, you know, even during our podcast yesterday, all of a sudden I see him, he's out there on his phone.
Yeah.
And after I go, what are you doing? And he goes, oh, I got an emergency at work. And so that may have been what happened.
Yeah. Your podcast is called The Big
Bad Broadcast.
Wait, I wanted to go through The Big Bada Bing Bada Bam Bada Boom Bada Bang 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 Broadcast from Bambalooza Bobbity Boobity Boobity.
This is how it came about. We were originally the Bitchin' Baby Boomers.
Right.
And some guy named My Dog told us that that was not a good idea. So we already had the website of the BBB Radio. So we had to go, what can we come up with so we don't have to change the website? So we came up with the Big Bad Broadcast. We're doing good now. Yeah,
I like that name, and I want to come back and talk about that, but since you brought that up and taking my advice on it, Andy Andrews, who this thing is a fundraiser for, he once talked me into having a guest on my show, and it was a fucking train wreck. And then he called me up. He said, the next day he spoke to me. He said, oh, you fucked up. You trusted me. And that's how I feel about you taking my advice about the name. Oh,
it's so funny because, you know, on our Facebook page, after like 2 months, we had over like 2,500 people, but no one watched the show. We would post something on the show and go, this week, Tommy Chong, thanks to you. And then all of a sudden they would go, you have a show?
Yeah. So you said you had one yesterday where Silky was doing, who'd you have on yesterday?
We had a guy named Terry Tyson, who is an authority on seance magic.
Ooh.
And you know, and that's what I've been doing lately is seance magic.
Really?
And, yeah.
Well, so, now let's stop there for a second. Seance magic in the it's not telling people that it's real, right? Or is
okay. So basically, my new show is there's a place called the Waverly Sanatorium, which 8,000 people died of tuberculosis in 4 years. And it's considered, because there was no cure for tuberculosis. The cure was they sat you in a bed and you faced the sun. And the sun was about the only thing that could make you feel better. And it's considered the most haunted place in America. So basically, the entire hour and 15 minutes is based on the Waverly Sanatorium. And I talk about how, and it's all made up, you know. But I've become sort of like a historian on this place. So all the things in it are based on fact. They just go a little bit further. And I talk about how I don't believe in ghosts. I don't believe in paranormal stuff. And I was working the Louisville Comedy Club, and the owner took me to this place on a tour, and they were selling boxes of artifacts. And I have a box, and I start taking out the stuff, and I go, I don't believe in it. I hope nothing comes through. And a lot of weird stuff happens. It's really, I had a paranormal guy. So when I started doing it, right, and I have a web page called the WaverlySeance.com. And when people went to the website, all of a sudden I get a call from the historians at the Waverly that said to me, you know, we don't believe that your website is factually true. And I said, it just says the first line, inspired on an actual place. I can say whatever I want, you know?
Right, yeah.
Based on a true story. Yeah. So they So they sent me to they sent a paranormal investigator to my show. And the guy was really crazy. I mean, he was crazy. Yeah. I have a tray that is filled with, like, you know, I have a background in the hospital. I worked in a hospital for years as an X-ray technician. So I kind of know. So I looked up who made their surgical instruments, and I made a tray with, like, big syringes that were like actual stainless steel meat tenderizers, you know, and I aged it, and I put their logo of the company that made it, and I pass this around at the seance, and it gets to the guy, and all of a sudden I look over and he's crying. He's got tears, literal tears running down his face. And I go, "Are you okay?" And he goes, "I'm just feeling the vibes of the pain that these instruments created, you know?" And meanwhile, he's my biggest promoter. I use him on my website to promote my show. He goes, "I'm a paranormal advisor, and I was freaked out, man. I was freaked out." So it was kind of cool.
That's pretty funny, because I started, when I first started in radio, my thing, I was like on a Harry Houdini mission to debunk all that kind of stuff.
Right, right.
And my friend was going to a car wash, and I was with him, and I was waiting in the office while his car was going to be clean, and he told his friend, "Yeah, he does a show with psychics." He goes, "Oh, you're into that?" I said, "No, I'm not into that." And he said, "Well, what do you do it for?" And I basically was doing a demonstration to tell him how phony it is. And I said, I just said, "Well, you have a brother named Alexander, or the name Alexander means something to you." He suddenly passed and basically started just anything that came into my mind, just saying it. And I looked at the guy, and his jaw was at the bottom. He goes, "How the fuck do you know that?" He calls wife and tell her what you just said. I was bullshitting. I didn't get him.
Right. Yeah, that's how those cold readings work, though. You know, I have a thing, but I have stuff in my show that is just mind-blowing. I go to the guy, "I'm going to prove to you that there's no ghosts here. I need someone in the audience with a phone that has a recording device." I put it on the table, and I walk away, and I go, "All right," and I'm kind of rolling my eyes. "Oh, okay, is there a ghost in the room?" You know, and you don't hear anything. And I go, "Is the ghost, can you tell me what your name is?" You don't hear anything. You know, "Can you tell me where you are?" I don't hear anything. "And can you tell me, you know, what you want from us?" And I go, "See, no ghost." Hit play. It goes, "Is there a ghost in the room?" And you hear, "Yes." It goes, "What's your name?" "Anne." "Where are you?" "Standing behind you."
"Oh.
What do you want?" "I want to play." And it's on their phone. They take it home, you know. Oh, man. And I'm nowhere near the phone. So I go, "Well, look, I'm not playing with her. You sit in that chair." And they sit in the chair, and all of a sudden, I go, "If she were to touch you right now, would you believe you're here?" And then all of a sudden, the guy goes, "Oh, my God." It's pretty scary. It's pretty scary. You know?
Yeah, so. People, and, you know, people can believe, and then when you have that kind of evidence, boy, I can't even say simple words, I'm telling you. But when they have that kind of evidence, it kind of makes the hair stand up on the back of their neck, and then all of a sudden they become rabid believers in
and you know, and my whole thing about this was, you know, like years ago when a magician would come to town, people actually thought he had magic powers, you know. And now with YouTube and Facebook, there's magic everywhere, and some of it's really good, some of it's really crap. And then when you see somebody with even like a great close-up guy, you don't really think, "Oh my God, that guy's got magic powers." You go, "Man, that guy's skilled."
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I just thought, like, if you took something magic and presented something that no one's ever seen before, because everything in this act is original, and Silky helped me design most of it, and then kind of put it with this thing where people don't really know whether, you know, this paranormal stuff is real or not, it kind of gives you that feeling of, like, I guess what those old-time magician guys felt.
Yeah.
It's kind of cool, you know?
Yeah, I've had lots of ghost hunters who believe in that stuff, and, you know, definitely have. But the same kind of story that you told as a magical effect, that thing is what they're picking up on, EVM meters and all those kind of
things. Yeah, yeah, and that's what it's called, EVP.
EVP,
you know, yeah. Which is, yeah, but this is... I would love to tell you how it works, because you would be very interested, but I'm not.
Yeah. It is what it is. But now, there was somebody by the name of Ferrantino on your podcast. Is that your daughter or
my daughter? Yeah, my daughter.
What does she do? That
my daughter is a very famous playwright.
Playwright, I did not
know
that.
My daughter is on fire. She had a play on. She wrote. She went to NYU, then got her master's at Hunter, and then Yale called and said, "We really want you to graduate from here. We'll pay you to come to school here." Graduated from Yale with another master's. While she was there, she wrote a play called "Ugly Lies the Bone," which is an Albert Einstein quote. Beauty is skin deep, but ugly lies the bone. And it went to off-Broadway. But when I say off-Broadway, it's Roundabout, which is actually kind of on Broadway. It's a big theater. And Meryl Streep's daughter played the lead in it, Mamie Gummer. And it got the New York Times Critic Choice Award. So it went directly from there to the National Theater in London. And 900-seat theater. And it's based upon a female veteran that gets involved in a roadside bomb and gets disfigured. And when she comes back, she's a kindergarten teacher, so obviously she can't teach because she's very disfigured. So they tell her that she'd have to be on a life of drugs or she can go into virtual reality healing, which is actually something they have. Wow. So in London, they built the stage for $750,000. So the whole 900-seat theater was in a virtual reality thing every time she went in. And then she wrote another show, Amy and the Orphan, and that is was bought by Jason Bateman. And they're making a Netflix movie, and she's going to direct it.
Wow, that's so cool.
Yeah, she then just finished the a Netflix series for De Niro called Daughter of the King, which is a mafia story told through Maya Lansky's daughter. And she has like a 6-movie deal.
Wow.
So, yeah.
So she, and you must be very proud. Congratulations.
It's amazing. It's amazing. And my son is killing it, too. My son's a big advertise exec in Austin, Texas, and he's like 28 and making more money than I ever made in my life. You know,
I did good. Yeah, you did good. Congratulations, way to go. The playwright stuff, though, because live entertainment took such a big hit, and I thought the theater business, especially in New York, was completely dead. Am I wrong about that, or do you?
Yeah, she had a play called A Year to Come that was slated to go into the main room at Roundabout, you know, the main theater, and just because of budgets, because it takes place in a Florida backyard, and then they did it in San Diego, they have to build a screen room like in Florida and a pool. She had an actual in-ground pool on the stage that was heated. And I go to her, you got $750,000 backdrops of virtual reality. You got a pool on stage. I can't even get a beer at my gigs.
Right.
So that show's on hold right now. And it's the theater business. That's why she's really going to movies.
Yeah. In the last 25 hours or so, however long we've been doing this, just the conversation, there's a lot of repeating themes, but the overriding one, of course, is this weird time we're going through as a human race, and a lot of people like me just pessimists about it. Where are you with it? Are we ever going to get through this? Is it ever going to be over?
Unfortunately, it becomes very political.
Yeah, no, it doesn't have to be, right?
No. What I'm just saying is I feel that this is something that, you know, I don't know. I have my own things that kind of like, you know, get vaccinated. You know what I mean? Get vaccinated. Get the boosters. I feel really sorry for the people the first round that got sick and died because they had no choice. No one knew what was going on. But now you got these idiots that refuse to get vaccinated, and I'm offending anybody. I'm sorry. Go get vaccinated. You know, we're not going to get out of it until people start believing in science and not horse medicine or Joe Rogan. You know, what is his story?
Yeah. You know? Well, here's where, and you're right, it does get political, but here's where, and I talked to Jeff Dwoskin before you on this topic too. Because on the vaccine, there are people who, and I don't, this is a question for you, whether you believe they actually believe this or they're just being political about it, is they raise this concern about the vaccine not being safe, and far from, even more than not being safe, being like a conspiracy to either infect you or robotize you or put chips in you, all these different kind of conspiracy theories. The question is not, are those conspiracy theories valid? Is, do you think they actually believe them, or they just need something to present their
side of politics? Before I came on, I just saw an article with these people that were saying that, you know, these QAnon people that were waiting for Kennedy Jr. to come back. Yeah, well, now they're saying that he did show up at the rally, but he was disguised as Trump. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. Right. So how do you rationalize with these people?
Right.
Well, you know what I mean? It's just, you know, here, I mean, I saw this guy this morning, this one of the senators, he was going, look, you know, you got to have a license to drive a car. You know, you have to have a polio vaccine to go to school. You know, maybe we got to make this, you know, saying, hey, this is something that's got to be done. Because until we do that, there's always going to be different variances, and it's crap.
Yeah. But even beyond COVID and all that stuff, this idea of people believing in these false realities, part of your career as a magician is being able to kind of present false realities as entertainment. Do you think there's any way to really break that spell? Because people are buying into magic in a sense presented by one side or another, but believing in these, like JFK didn't die, he's still in there disguised as Trump. That is provable, like, and you know, using this kind of
tool. I mean, it's just crazy. I don't think they can actually believe this stuff.
Well, that's what you would think. It was like, didn't really turn that scarf into an egg, did he? And if you went out and people were still, no, he absolutely did. I saw him.
Well, you know, I read this article. They were saying that during the beginning of the pandemic, people were at home and they were so frustrated with being at home. They got sick of watching TV. So they went to the internet, and people were having fun creating these stupid stories, and then people just started believing them.
Yeah.
It's crazy. I mean, it's just crazy, you know, and it's just, I don't know. You know, when we were, you know, when we were growing up, I always say this about politics. When we were growing up, Republicans, Democrats fought like hell before the election. Then whoever was in, they said, all right, he's in. Now let's think about the country. Right. You know what I mean? And it's not like that anymore.
No, definitely.
You know, it's like Mitch McConnell going, anything he says, I'm going to deny. You know what I mean? It's like, okay, that's really American.
Yeah.
And I, you know, and it's, you know, I'm not trying to be political, but I mean, that's the difference. I mean,
no, that definitely you know? Is. I made that comment reading the news this morning because at 5 a.m. I was like here by myself, and I was just like, well, I'll just read what's in the news. And one of the things was on Biden policy, and I said, who cares what a policy plan is? Because no, I don't care if it's a Republican or a Democrat. The other side isn't going to let you get anything done with that policy anyway. So what?
Exactly. And, you know, and it's just nuts. It's like in these, you know, like you look at like crazies like Marjorie Taylor Greene. I mean, we would never have somebody like that when we were kids or, you know, or our parents. They would be like, get the hell out of here. It's just crazy. It's just, it's really crazy. Let's not get political, but I got to tell you, I just read this story on the news the other day that this guy, you talk about stupid criminals, this guy robbed a Wells Fargo bank and he got something like 20 grand. And 5 hours later, tried to deposit in the ATM at the same bank that he robbed. You can't write something that funny.
No, it wasn't in Florida.
No. Thank God. It was like somewhere in the Midwest because it usually is in Florida.
Yeah. My friend Jonesy does a podcast called Weird as Fuck News. But he said most of his stories come out of Florida.
Yeah, they do. They do. Yeah. They do. It's crazy. You know, it's there's a thing called Florida Man.
Right.
Wherever you go on Florida Man, you can find every day of the week some sort of bizarre crime that happened for every day of the week in Florida for, you know, a year. Crazy.
Yeah.
Crazy.
So is the plan now, because I know Spooky likes to work on Halloween, no? Is the plan to go do more work, or is you just taking it as it comes?
I have, there's a theater here in Titusville called the Titusville Playhouse. It's like a 400-seat theater. and they just hired me to do four of my shows there. And I said to the guy, you know, I was honest with him. I said, I need a director and I need this. And he said to me, why do you need a director? I go, because there's probably plenty of stuff in the show that shouldn't be there. And he goes, wow. I'll give you a director and I'll give you, you know, a musical director, a lighting guy, and, you know, come in, we'll do a couple of weeks of rehearsal. And so I got some good plans for that show. It's going to be really
good. Holy moly. That's good. That sounds like a dream come true, that you get that kind of support. You never got that in a comedy club, did you, ever?
No. I did get that support, though, believe it or not, working with Crosby, Stills, and Nash.
Oh, yeah. Well,
I mean, Graham Nash came out every night and introduced me. Did I ever tell this story? This is funny. The first, I was working in Philadelphia, your hometown, right? And I was working at the Tower Theater, which is like 1,500 seats. So the local DJ came out and went, hey, and I've been working with them for a while. He goes, hey, you like Crosby, Stills, and Nash? And they're like, ah. And he goes, well, here's your comedian. And he walks off. And I went on, and it was the worst show of my life. I mean, it was during the whole show, I'm hearing CSN, 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 right? And I'm going, look, I only have to be out here for 20 minutes. You know, shut up. I'll stay out here for 30, you know? And I walk off stage, and David Crosby walks up to me, and he just hugs me in a bear hug, and he goes, man, they fucking hated you. I go, thanks. He goes, no shit, man. They fucking hated you. And I went into my dressing room, and I was like, well, I guess that's the end of the ride. You know? And Graham Nash walked in, and he said, hey, Johnny boy, I just have to tell you, man. He goes, I really hurt for you as an artist. You should never have to go through that crap. He goes, you know, you're better than that, and they don't know what they got. So from now on, every night, I'm going to come out and introduce you. Every night, no matter where we were, he'd come out and go, hey, it's great to be here in Philadelphia. Next show. It's like the next show at the same place. It's great to be here in Philadelphia. You got the greatest fans in the world. And you watch, and the place is filling up like time-lapse photography. I think the concert's going to start. And he goes, David, Steven, and I aren't quite ready to come out now, but we're going to bring out a guy, a friend of ours, who we met a couple of years ago, who we thought we'd make permanent part of our show because he's great, and he's a good friend of mine, so you better give him the respect he deserves. My good friend, John Ferrantino, and he'd walk out and he'd hug me, and the crowd would be like, this guy knows them.
Oh, yeah, right.
It was like night and day. It's crazy. Yeah.
Cool. That was your the first one where the DJ kind of screwed you up. That was your first time playing for opening for any kind of like major rock.
Oh, no. The way the journey started was my mother had been really sick, and my manager at the time wanted to keep me in town. So the old comedy clubs had this like 3-month thing that you couldn't be in one club over 3 months. So he called him up and said, hey, look, we'll give you a good deal on the price, but I got to keep him in town. His mother's not doing well. So they go, okay, as long as his picture doesn't appear in the paper at once. So David Crosby and Graham Nash were doing a solo tour. It was at Westbury Music Fair. They opened up. They weren't doing well on sales. And all of a sudden, the guy opens up the paper, and there's John Fertino's face in like 7 ads. And they go, get this guy. He must be a big local draw. And that's how it happened. And then the next night, I did Philadelphia, and I was doing the sword through neck trick. And I stuck the woman in the back of the neck with the sword gently, and she peed on her stage. And just like constantly, not even a little bit, like to the point where I had to address it. And I rolled up my pant legs. I'm going, wet breakage, aisle number 3, you know, stuff like that. And I walked off stage, and Crosby was like in a coma laughing. And he goes, dude, any man that can make a woman pee in her pants, we want as our permanent opening act. And that lasted for 10 years. So. Oh.
Well, I have the criteria. I've made plenty of women pee in their pants.
But not on stage.
Yeah, no, not on stage. Well, I thank you for helping
me. No problem, man. Good luck with this.
Yeah. Have you ever met Jeff Altman?
Yes. Oh. It's funny when you said that originally, but I know him as a comedian. Right.
Right. No, he started as a magician at the Magic Castle where he worked, but then went to the Comedy Store and did his comedy from there, and then became film and television, and then continued to do comedy, and then came back to Magic as a full-time type of thing. after all that was done. So yeah, well, he's had a very robust career.
Well,
so
I'm gonna stay on and watch. I'm gonna stay on and watch.
So your podcast drops today at noon, doesn't it not?
Yeah.
Well, we look forward to big things from you. And John, thank you for helping me.
No problem. Anytime. All right.
Appreciate it.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye for now. And now, the aforementioned Jeff Altman will be with me in just 1 second. I just want to bring up the total right now. We've raised $24,581. We're not done. Please continue to donate. The link is in the description, and it's scrolling across the bottom of the screen right now. The bid on the guitar is at $1,000. The bid on the bidet is at $60, and if Stanhope comes back on at some point today, we're going to ask him if he can sign that, and I believe that will bring the value of the bidet up. Ladies and gentlemen, please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Jeff Altman to the Wine Dog TV podcast. Hey, welcome, Jeff. I feel like I'm going to let you down, because, and I'm not in a huge way, but I asked you if we could perform magic for each other in this setting. Now, I did not realize that I was going to be operating on half a brain cell by the time I got to 22 hours. This is the 22nd hour into this thing now.
You're the 22nd hour?
Yeah, 22nd straight hour, yeah. So, operating on a half a brain cell, I'm not all that confident, but I'm going to try anyway.
Okay.
Sure. Okay. Can I go first? So after I screw it up, you can do something to cover for me and rebound.
Whatever you want, man. It's your show, buddy.
Okay, I want to do something. Let's see. There's a card trick. Are you familiar with card tricks? Have you ever seen a card trick before?
A couple.
Okay. Let me see if I can do this, because I'm going to need something like this to be a, let me see this. Yeah. There you go. We can use that as a stand for the card check. Now just stop me, any card you like. Wait, you know what? Can you see this here?
Yeah. Now I can.
Yeah. This is difficult doing it this way, isn't it? Aha. Uh-huh. So stop me in any card you like.
More towards you, Matt. Closer to you.
Yeah.
Right there.
Which one?
King of Diamonds.
This King of Diamonds. Now, you say King of Diamonds. Now, can we see that right there? I'll leave the King of Diamonds. Now, again, I'm operating on half a brain cell here. Now, I want to tell you that before you signed on today, I had written a name on the back of every single card in the deck. And one of the names is Andy Andrus, who, I don't know if you can see that, Andy Andrus, who is, what this benefit is all about. Next one is David Letterman. I'm sure you're familiar with him. Jay Leno, Mitzi Shore, I'm sure you know that name. Johnny Carson, Rodney Dangerfield, on and on. Different name on every single card in the deck. Now, if I turn around this King of Diamonds that you selected, let's see if we can show the name there.
Fantastic.
Hey, not too bad for half a brain cell, but the presentation sucked, but I really can't speak at this point. My lips are getting stuck and verbs are not happening.
You know what, Matt? If you keep looking down at that sweater you're wearing, it will wake you up instantly.
Well, I appreciate that. I don't think anything's going to wake me up instantly at this point. I'm like having DTs, but carrying through, we have.
That was a pretty good card trip, buddy.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Coming from you, obviously, that's high praise, but, you know, I appreciate you, you know, putting up with that, because, again, I'm like, yeah, I'm so shot, man.
Matt, what is the record?
What is the record for the podcast?
Yeah, what is the record? What is the all-time record?
45 hours and 46 minutes.
Say that again?
We have to get 45 hours and 46 minutes. So we have to get to 46 hours to break it.
Oh my gosh!
Right,
you got your work cut out for you, buddy.
Another 21 hours. That's all.
That's it.
We'll be fine. I have some guys helping me in the background, but they're kind of missing right now. So John Farentino, who was on right before you, was talking about your career, and he said he knew you from as a comedian. Most people do. Most people don't associate you with sleight of hand, but this, as we discussed on last time you were on my show on the Mind Dog TV podcast, you started. Most people think you came to magic after comedy and television and film and all that stuff, but you started in magic and in the Comedy Store before you even started.
Before I ever came to Los Angeles, I had my dreams and hopes set on being a funny magician at the Magic Castle in Hollywood.
Right.
And that evaporated fast once I got on the comedy stage.
And now, why did that happen? Because obviously you're very good, and you studied with the great Di Vernon, and your dad was a very well known, very successful sleight of hand artist. Why was the Magic Castle not satisfactory for you?
Well, for one, it would be pretty hard to make a living just working the Magic Castle once every 3 months, and the money they pay ain't the best.
Yeah.
And you know, it would have been hard to have eked out a living that like that somehow. So I got up on the comedy stage where I was making no money, sort of put together some sort of a skit or an act, and took that out in the road, and then I did make some money. So
wow. Well, good for you. Do you have something that will blow my mind?
Well, I have a deck of cards here. Can you see the pretty?
Yeah.
Pretty
should large? I make you? Should I make you full screen? Do we need to see me in this? Could I do something like this?
No, but you're gonna have to participate with me. But you don't need to be on camera.
Okay, so I'm gonna put you on camera. You can still hear me, right?
Yeah, and you can still see me, right?
Yes, absolutely. You're okay. Nice and big now. Everybody can see you.
Let me begin by giving the cards a little mix and show you that the cards are all regular deck of blue bicycle playing cards. The backs are all the same. The faces are all different. I can even shuffle these cards face up so you can see them being mixed and give them a little cut. These cards are mixed and shuffled. Now, what I'm going to do is this, Matt. I'm going to have you in a second just tell me to stop four times. I'm going to deal the cards face up on the table, face up, one at a time. You tell me when to stop, okay?
Okay.
As I deal cards down, I'll deal them very slowly like this, and you're going to say stop four times anywhere you
stop.
Want.
Stop.
I'll put this card aside.
Okay.
Anytime you like, say stop. You let me go.
Stop.
Let me go through the whole right here.
Yes, sir. Yes.
This is card number two.
Stop.
Card number three.
Right. Stop.
Card number four. Ooh, that's a beauty.
Oh.
Well, let's see how you did.
Okay, let's see how I did.
Well, you stop here at a seven. I'll stand up so that everybody can see this. You stop here at a seven. And the strange thing is that you also stopped here at a seven of diamonds, a seven of spades, and a seven of hearts.
Woo!
Which is pretty good if you've got the whole deck in front of you with nothing else.
Wow, very cool, man. Very cool. Where is the audience? Oh, yeah. There they are. And the audience is a little slow. They've probably been up too long, too. You know, when I saw you do magic on Letterman, you did a card trick for him. He was, and I know you're very good friends with him, but it seemed like he was trying to make it as difficult for you to do a magic trick as possible. Like, he's a tough guy to do a magic trick for.
Absolutely. He's really not. He's actually not a tough guy to do magic for. But in that particular instance, I think I know the one you were talking about. He was a little tough, but we had a lot of fun doing that, as I recall.
Yeah. I think it was 2015 or thereabouts. I don't know. Right around when he was getting ready to retire and that stuff. But it just seemed like he might have just been trying to antagonize you, but you were very You handle it so well, and it's an inspiring thing to see, because we've all been there doing like close up magic, and you just get that one guy that's really going to make the trick tough on you, and that's where the experience and training comes in, and where your talent and all the skill that you've put together over so many years pays off in dealing with those people. It's not doing the trick for a magician, because they're going to be kind to let you do it, even if you're bumbling like me with half a brain cell.
Nah.
Yeah.
Matt, have you got time for a quick one?
Yes.
Okay. Honey, could you come in? It was a joke, Matt.
I get it.
Quick one. Honey, come in.
Yeah, I got it.
You
I
are
get,
sleepy.
I got okay. it. No, I am sleepy.
This is a vase that my mother made. My mother passed away in 2007, but she was an expert ceramicist, and she made this wonderful little bowl that's empty, and I'm going to show you a little trick with a deck of cards and my mother's bowl. Can you see that clearly?
Yes, we can.
Okay. I'm going to use a card here. I'll use my the first card I'm going to use happens to be this one here. That's, can you see that?
Yeah, but it looks like a jack of spades, jack of clubs.
Jack of clubs.
Clubs.
That goes on top of the vase. Jack of clubs. I have another one right behind it here that I'm going to use. Let's see. I'll use this one here, the ace of spades.
Gotcha.
Ace of spades. Can you see that card?
Yep. We got so far.
Ace of spades goes underneath like this. Now watch. We've got the jack of clubs and the ace of spades. You saw me clearly put those under and on top of the vase, right?
Yes. Jack of clubs is on top and the ace of spades is on the bottom.
Watch the ace as it travels up through the bowl, all the way up through the cards, and comes to the top of the pack.
Wow.
Watch as the jack of clubs travels all the way from the top, all the way down through the vase.
Woo!
Jack of clubs.
Wow. Very cool stuff. Appreciate that. You know what? Your hands are very, are as good as ever. So are there big magic shows opening up? Because I know a lot of magic conventions and things like that are happening, or generally happen in like Orlando and places like that are hotbeds for. So are there shows still going on? Do you know?
Yeah, there's still conventions going on, but they're far and few between because of this COVID eruption that happened with the new variant. And they've got to be very careful. I was at a convention during the Delta variant and in Charlotte, and I didn't catch anything, but it was a great convention. And there's one coming up in Chicago in April that I'm hoping to get to. Conventions are always going on, but it's just this damn virus has kept us from meeting as often as we can.
It's messed up, and I'm really pessimistic about it, and I hate to be a pessimist, but it just feels like it's like never gonna go away.
I know.
Well,
I'll show you a trick I did for Ricky J and fool them. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to drop a card on the table,
right,
Matt, and the audience has got to believe me that this was unrehearsed and absolutely.
No, we didn't work anything out. Absolutely not. This is not.
We have not worked anything, Matt. Correct.
Yeah, absolutely. We wouldn't, because I was trying to impress you, and I wanted to learn from you. So yes, we didn't.
I want you to just name any card in the deck.
Any card in the deck. Four of hearts.
Do you know? By the way, the four of hearts. Do you know whose favorite card that was?
Di Vernon. No, I don't know.
Yes, it was.
Okay.
It was Di Vernon.
Good guess.
If this is the four of hearts, would you be pretty happy?
Yeah.
Shit. It was a six of clubs. You forgot it, I think. Look, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll put the six of clubs here on the table and I'll shuffle them and watch to see if you can see if this card moves. Okay, Matt?
Okay.
The six of clubs.
Oh.
Did you see it move?
I did see it move.
What was the card you named?
Four of Hearts.
That's the one.
Ooh. Di Vernon is with me tonight.
Yes, he is. Yes, I think I'll stop with that one since I fucked it up.
You did?
Well, you're supposed to name the card. I didn't get it. Ricky J named the six of clubs, and I got him. Because that's the card least named by magicians.
Well, I didn't. Well, see, we didn't work anything out. So there you go.
No, but you knew that the Four Hearts was Vernon's favorite card. I think that's pretty cool.
I think I was just a lucky guy. It's a matter of working on half a brain cell. I apologize for that. You know, I wanted to be sharp for this. I was like, I want to have some cool magic on there. And then 5 o'clock this morning, I said, I don't know if I could do magic. I feel like I can't even drive a car or walk, really, for that matter. I was like, I don't know what I'm going to do when Jeff gets here. So I practiced on one of my co-hosts, and I totally screwed it up.
A different trick or the trick you did for me?
A different trick. I didn't. So I said, no, I can't go with that one. That's too difficult. It required too much hand work, and I was like, no, I can't do it. My brain and hands are just not here. So I went with a self-working trick.
Oh, that's okay.
I punked out, but I was like, yeah, I wasn't going to take a chance on screwing it up again live in front of everybody. So I appreciate you being part of this. And this is a fundraiser for a comedian who was going through some real life challenges right now. And I called you up and asked you if you would do this, and you graciously said yes. And I appreciate that so much. And by the way, he says, he told me the other day, Jeff Altman was the first guy I saw at the Comedy Store doing the big pants thing. And so, you know, it means a lot to him that you're here doing this.
That's great. That's really terrific.
Thanks for coming, and be well, be safe. And maybe I'll see you in April in Chicago.
Out there, get vaccinated. Don't be stupid. Get that booster and get another booster if they offer it in 4 months.
Cool. Thank you, Jeff. And bye for now.
Great to see you.
The fabulous Jeff Altman, folks. I hope you enjoyed that. Cool magic. I'm glad he was not operating on a lack of sleep like I was, because I am seriously having some major. If this was a clinical study right now, they would just be taking notes at the speed of light. Well, his speech seems impaired. He doesn't seem to have understanding of the simplest little words. He doesn't get knock-knock jokes. Perhaps he's doing some damage to himself. That's how I feel right now. But we are raising money. Right now, we're at $24,581. Keep the donations coming. And the guitar bid is still at $1,000. Nobody's up that one bit. And we're getting a call from the man of the hour right now. I'm going to bring him in. Good morning, my friend. What happened? Did you just hang up on me? He tried to call.
I don't think so.
Oh, no, you didn't hang up on me. You're there. How are you?
Was Altman was just on, right?
Yeah, he was just on.
Okay. Yeah, I'm seeing a couple of different feeds. I wasn't sure.
Yo.
Oh, you can. I'm told you can rewind it somehow, which it was bizarre for a live feed. But, yeah, you just missed. Well, did you see Altman at all?
Yeah, I caught the end of it on there. And yee-hi-hi. It's fabulous. You're holding it together great, by the way.
I'm trying.
I mean, I can tell by your mannerisms, you're not going off and doing lines in the other room. Now that I know there's other rooms to that situation you're in, you don't have a bump corner. I can tell because you're an East Coast guy. And if you were an East Coast guy doing coke, everybody would know.
Yeah.
That's absolutely true. Picked a fight with people, and I did something I had to tell you because it's fucking embarrassing. And so, what better way to share embarrassment than on a live podcast?
But
yeah, so the surgeons, they're like fucking rock stars, and my guy comes around, and I'm told, I'm gonna have a couple of minutes or whatever. But I don't know. A little bit before that, I was adjusting shit, and I thought I had tape on my dick. So I thought my wound was being aerated, I guess is the wrong word, but I thought that my dick was allowing air to the wound. And I go, why is there tape on my penis? And he goes, there's tape on your penis? And then he peels the blanket back and there isn't. So like a perfectly played dirty joke on the surgeon who just removed organs. I showed him, like, I was like, hey man, would you check this out? And then he looked and it was my dick without tape on it. And I'm like, oh geez.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I'm glad that happened after surgery than before.
You don't want to make him feel like an idiot before he's going to cut you open.
Yeah, that was some CK-esque shit there. Like, hey man, look over here.
Yeah.
So it made me think of, like, probably why surgeons don't have a sense of humor, because whenever people talk to them, it's like this awkwardness, and then most people don't have a good sense of humor, and then they try to force humor on these guys, so they're just like, ugh, they just have an edge. Like comics, like, hey, I got a joke for you.
Yeah.
Like surgeons seem like they're bracing for something that's going to annoy them all the time, and then I show them my dick. So I'm glad I'm getting off of this floor soon.
You sound remarkably like yourself. Like, you don't sound drugged up on morphine or anything.
Yeah, because they told me I was not supposed to push the button nearly as much, and since I've been doing that, I've returned to a normal state of drugged up instead of super elevated drugged up.
Wow,
here comes some more. Howdy.
Yeah,
okay, it looks like I better concentrate type stuff going on here. No, she needs to concentrate. I can keep going. All right.
Don't distract her with your erection. Like,
no, no, I'm getting some safe. I'm like a car pulling into pit stop. I'm not doing anything but getting my tires changed.
Right, right. But this morning,
I'll let you go. Who's the next guest?
Next guest is probably it's a while away. Alex Liam, which is not till 12:30, Got him. He's a British. I think he's a British comedian. Might be a Welsh comedian. I don't know.
And I think you're doing a smart thing in not having Inman on in the middle. Right?
Yeah.
Has he been on in the middle? Because Inman wears people out, especially if they're in recovery.
He was on in the chat rooms attacking people last night. I got to do my Inman impersonation for everybody in the funhouse last night. It was kind of amusing because they like, I think I nailed him pretty well.
Oh, good. Yeah, yeah. Because he's, I think people appreciate impressions of him way more than him.
Yeah, no doubt about it. He's too much for people, too intense.
I started liking him again because I had a couple phone calls since I got the cancer diagnosis, and he just talked like a regular guy.
Yeah, no, he's.
I'm gonna start calling him Karen. It's like, easy, Karen, and he's always yelling.
Yeah. No, yesterday morning when I had him on, we went for an hour, and about 10 minutes before he wrapped it up, he just said, and he didn't mention the Unbookables once. And at one point he got to it and he just said, it's all because of that film. And I said, well, really? What film would that be? And that got him angry at me because it's like, oh, there you go. You're mocking me. This is what Andy and Doug do.
Yeah, well, don't take much. And, I'm going to tell him that I got the Unbookables tattooed on my forehead that says Unbookables suck for an open casket ceremony. I don't mean the Unbookables movie sucks. I mean Inman sucks when he gets riled up about it. That's all. I was clearly the star of that movie, and he's the one who gets upset about it. I was the Patrick Swayze of that.
Yep. You
dropping a pancreatic cancer reference in on you,
and
that's how sharp I am.
The flag you have, or you're wearing at the beginning of the last shot, isn't that the same flag you were wearing in the Unbookables when you did the bowling?
No. And that's a Banjo Randy had that flag up on his wall. It was the only clean piece of laundry, so I use that for sheets when I stayed at Randy. And then I found out that was the flag of a guy who popped himself in the noggin and bled out on the flag.
Oh my God.
So not only was the sheets not clean and I was desecrating the flag, I was also desecrating a man's deathbed of sorts.
You're evil. You're just plain evil.
I'm unintentionally evil. I stumble onto and I'm just covered in blood and I go, oh, dang it. Here we go again. Okay. Wow.
Wow.
No. I'm getting insulin. This will be maybe the. Okay. Oh, it's not insulin. Is it a small needle?
Really small
needle. Okay. All right. I'm going to be brave and do this live.
Are you? Oh.
God.
Are you allowed to do this?
Oh, sweet guy. No. It didn't hurt. She's a good needler.
Wow. Well, don't get used to needles.
No, well, I know a friend of mine, I'll be tactful here. The widow of a former friend who may or may not have done heroin told me I had good veins.
Oh, that's not a good thing. That's not a good thing.
Yeah. I don't know if she's been on the podcast. I was going to suggest her, but I won't drop her name now with that lead up.
Yeah, there's plenty of time for that. Don't even worry about that. We'll just keep this going. I'm expecting at some point, Doug and maybe some of those people are going to stop in today to help us carry this thing to the end.
Oh, yeah. Jan Hope is what he sent me a thing saying, should I get back on there? Like, he gets all excited when he's on, this kind of thing. You know, he didn't plan it. He's not responsible for it.
Right.
So he gets all wound up and happy.
He took it to bed with him.
Yeah, that made me happy. You know, it's like I'm checking in with all my friends without having to listen to their bullshit directed at me.
Yeah, and no, you don't have to deal with pesky visitors coming to see you and bringing you flowers and stupid shit.
Yeah, hey, do you want to learn about the Jehovah's Witness religion? Yeah, sure. I'm stuck in bed on drugs. Why not?
Well, this phone call is going to give a lot of people a lot of optimism and hope, because you sound like Andy Andrus. Like yesterday, you sounded like Andy Andrus, but Andy Andrus on elephant tranquilizer. So.
Definitely. I feel a little human today.
Yeah, no, you sound like you. It's incredible.
Yeah, like you could be like near death and somebody says, I have a cherry popsicle for you, and things just turn around.
I saw the popsicle. I wasn't sure what that meant because you said popsicles are great, and I wasn't sure what you meant by that.
I don't even like cherry popsicles, but it was just that I got to eat it or have something that felt like moisture in my throat.
Yeah.
I don't know if you had a tube down your throat, but they kind of dry you a little.
Oh, so they didn't... I thought they had to cut you open. They went in through your throat to do this?
But I have a feeding... Don't I have a feeding tube down my throat? No. I think I do.
Okay.
I do. I don't know that it goes. Yeah.
Wow. Well, it doesn't matter. You didn't wake up for it.
No, I know it's good. She's on the phone. I've been trying to answer questions. She's on the phone. Oh, wow. That makes sense.
Are you in a? You don't have a roommate, do you?
No. Okay. No, you're in a private room. I'm in the ICU.
Okay, good.
And it's completely, I have a window view of the river, but it's so foggy, you can't even see a foot out. Wow. So I paid for the pineapple suite, and I did not get it.
Yeah, I can't.
That makes sense if you watch The White Lotus, which you don't have a TV.
I know, I get
it. Screw you, you don't get references.
I'm too exhausted to kind of laugh too hard today. It's like it hurts.
Oh, I know. Yeah, you're a terrible audience today. apparently being up 30 hours straight talking gonna zap your laugh box.
Right.
And you're no Bob and Tom this morning.
No, Jeff Altman did a very simple joke for me, and I just stood there staring at him. And he's like, that's a joke, Matt. I was like, yeah, I get it. It's just like, I don't have the energy to kind of laugh about it. But
and to be honest, you know, nobody's going to listen to a 40-hour podcast for any reason if you're on drugs.
Yeah.
Well, yapping and, you know.
I
don't know. Maybe I would.
I was smoking pot the whole night to get me through, because somehow Pot is an upper for me in certain, you know, creative wise, and it keeps me going sometimes. Mm-hmm. It will, but
then you hit a wall.
Yeah,
you hit a wall like Dale Earnhardt. Yeah. You know?
But then I smoke more and pick myself back up again.
Yeah. All right. Well, I'm going to close on that. Dale Earnhardt, that would have got a better response had you gotten some sleep.
Yeah, it would have been.
All right. Sir, I love you and everybody for, you know, getting concerned and helping me out here, because I am literally flat on my back.
Cool, man. We'll keep on fighting the fight for you, and you just keep on getting better.
All right, sir. Have a good call. I'll check in before you're done.
Okay, cool. Talk to you later.
I love mine dog. I love you. I love having the dog be the best friend of my mind.